What are the things considered as pure substances according to the scientist? According to us, we feel like if it is pure in the sense it doesn't contain any impurity or any other kind of things mixed up, okay, then we can call them as pure substance. For example, if we got milk directly from the cattle, right? So what we'll think? We'll think that it's pure. Okay, but according to the scientist, the milk is not pure, because the milk consists of different kinds of components in it, and each component present in the milk, by the physical techniques we can separate all those components, and each one is having its unique property. So that's why milk is, though the milk is directly from the cattle or the fresh milk, is also not considered as pure, right? So according to the scientist, what are the pure substances? Elements and compounds. Elements and compounds considered as pure substances. So why elements considered as pure substances is, if you have taken any element and break the element into simpler pieces, into atoms. So one particular element, like if I take any gold, silver, oxygen, okay, anything. Okay, so if I want to break the element, I'll get only that particular atoms, no other atoms or no other components present in it. That's why elements are considered as pure. Understood? In the same way, compound is also considered as pure. Why the compound is considered as pure? Compound is a combination of different components, but though it is a combination of different components, all those components combine to show only one single property. Okay, so if it is common salt in water, whatever it is, so the common salt, if we have taken NaCl, NaCl is a combination of sodium and chlorine, though it's a combination of different components or the elements, both sodium and chlorine shows one singular property, that is sodium chloride. Sodium won't show its own characteristic, like retaining their characteristic, and chlorine won't show its own characteristic. They both combine to give the only one property what the sodium chloride is having. Understood? Then we can call it as pure substance. So next, mixtures. How many types of mixtures are there, children? Homogeneous mixtures, heterogeneous. Actually, what do you mean by mixtures? If two or more substances, elements, compounds, or both mix up together in a proportions do not undergo any chemical change but retain the characteristic resulting mass is called mixture. Irrespective of the proportions, if we have mixed anything, and though you are mixing different components, their components having their own or with retaining properties is called a mixture. Understood? So when we go with mixtures, mixtures are of two types. One is homogeneous mixtures and other one is the heterogeneous mixture. What do you mean by homogeneous mixture, children? The components present in that mixture uniformly spreading throughout the composition. We can't differentiate it. We don't have to see any kind of phases in it. It shows only one single phase, but the components which are present in the homogeneous mixture shows individual properties. Right? So no.
Yes, ma'am.
So when we considered heterogeneous mixture is a combination of different kinds of components irrespective of their proportion. But though they are mixed up, they show different phases. By seeing the solution itself, we can able to sketch, or we can able to screen out that something is mixed with that. Okay, so alloy. You know alloy, no? What do you mean by alloy?
Ma'am, it is a homogeneous mixture of metals.
Yes, metals, non-metals, non-metals, sometimes metals and non-metals also. Though they mixed up with metals and non-metals, they won't react. Okay, to enhance the property of the metal, to enhance the characteristics of the metal, so alloys are raised up. 90% of metals are alloyed in form. Sand and salt, heterogeneous. We can easily find out the sand and salt which is mixed up, though it takes time to separate the components, but we can easily feel it. Understood or no? Next.
Ma'am.
So these are the examples of homogeneous mixture as we have discussed. Heterogeneous mixtures, we can see that here the fruits are, we can see the different fruits are mixed up. And here iron and sulfur powder. So when you place a bar magnet near to the iron and sulfur powder, so iron got separated by using this bar magnet, okay, and sulfur got separated. Okay, iron is having its own property and sulfur is having its own property. So you can see the fruits over here, each and individual fruit is having its own characteristic. We can easily pick it up what components are present in it. Solution is a special type of homogeneous mixture, mixed up composed of two or more substance in it. Okay, solution is a combination of solute and the solvent. Solute is nothing but the quantity which we have taken in a limited or less quantity, one is considered as solute. Major quantity is nothing but solvent. So when I consider salt water or the salt solution, salt we will take like limited quantity when we compare with the solvent, right? So this salt is considered as solute and the water is considered as solvent. So here there are three types of solutions, two solutions, colloidal solutions, and the other one is suspensions. So based on the examples, we need to differentiate what kind of solution is it. Is this like salt solution? It comes under true solutions because the salt is completely dissolved in water. So we can't differentiate two phases and the particles are very, very small. Colloidal solution, it seems like homogeneous. It seems like homogeneous or it seems like true solution, but it is completely heterogeneous. Okay, the components are bigger than true solution and smaller than suspension. Okay, suspension solution, chalk in water. Okay, when we have added the solute in the solvent, after some time we can find that the solute particles are unstable. After some time, if you leave the solution, all the solute particles will be placed at the, where they're placed, they'll settle at the bottom of the beak. Okay, next, true solutions. So these are the different characteristics of true solution. A solution is a homogeneous mixture of two or more substances. The particles of solute in a solution cannot be seen by naked eye. A solution does not allow beam of light to scatter. A solution is stable. The solute from a solution cannot be separated by filtration or mechanically. Example, salt in water.
Scattering of light when it is passed through one of the solutions.
Very good. Scattering of light when it is passed through a solution containing a beaker or a transparent, this thing. So these solute particle or these particles which are present in the solution absorbs the light and they simply scatters the light. This shows that the particles are bigger in size. If the size of the particles are very small like true solution, it doesn't show any Tyndall effect. Suspension shows partial Tyndall effect. Why? Because when you add the solute to the solvent, when you dissolve it, these particles are in the disturbed manner and the particles are bigger in size. So when you pass the light, they absorb the light and they scatter the light. After some time, if you leave the solution, like we are talking about suspension, if we are leaving the solution aside so that all the particles will be settled at the bottom and we will see a clear solution, then pass the white light. Okay, what you will observe, children? What you will observe? How Tyndall effect? Suspension shows partial Tyndall effect. When the particles are scattering, you'll get it shows Tyndall effect. After settling, it doesn't show any Tyndall effect. Any doubts?
No, ma'am.
So when we consider colloidal solution shows the Tyndall effect because the size of particles are bigger than the true solution, smaller than the suspension. Colloidal solution. A solution is a heterogeneous mixture of two or more substances. The particles of solute in a solution cannot be seen by the naked eye. A solution does allow a beam of light to scatter. A solution is unstable. The solute from a solution cannot be separated by filtration or mechanically. Example, These are the examples we have given for the two solutions, but what are the examples for the colloidal solutions? Soap solution, egg albumin in water. Okay, these two are the examples of like emulsions, milk in water. Yes, all these are the examples for colloidal solution. These are the examples for true solutions I have given in this slide. Please correct it. Okay, these are the different examples for the colloidal solutions. Okay, as we have already discussed all this. Okay, suspensions. What are the characteristics of suspensions? One is heterogeneous. Particle size ranges greater than 10 to the power of minus 1. That means it is very big, like quite big when compared to true solutions and colloidal solutions. They are nanometer in size. That means we can see with our naked eye. Separation with the help of filter paper, because the particles are bigger so that we can easily filter with the filter paper. Appearance opaque. Appearance is opaque. It's not transparent. It is complete opaque, and it is unstable. But after settling at the bottom, they show stability, partial stability, and partial tendon effect. Any doubts?
No, ma'am.
Next important concept: separating the components of a mixture. So, what are the three reasons for separating the components of a mixture? First one, to get the pure sample of a substance. Second one, to remove any undesirable or harmful components. And the third one, to obtain the useful components of a mixture. So let us discuss with first one, to get a pure sample of a substance. Okay, in the laboratory, if you want to go with the research or any other experimental things, you should take the reactants, or you should take the initial source in the pure form. If it is any impure thing is present, so that it leads to side reaction. Understood? So when we consider the pure samples, we need to consider the pure samples so that it is in the research work, everything to be taken in the form of pure. Next, to remove any undesirable or harmful components. So if the mixture consists of different kinds of components, the undesired thing will be removed. If we won't remove the undesired thing, it leads to side reaction. For example, if I mixed up the rice with the grain or the pebbles, definitely you are going to remove the pebbles from the rice. Otherwise, it is very much harmful to us. We can't cook the rice with pebbles, right? So that any harmful components or any unwanted components or with the undesirable components, we can easily remove it. Next, to obtain the useful components of a mixture. So for example, if you consider the crude oil is a combination of different kinds of fuels. Okay, all those fuels are very, very necessary, and each one is having its unique property. So to separate that means the components of a mixture are very much useful. Then we need to go for the separation technique. Irrespective of physical separation or with the chemical separation technique, we need to select the separation technique. So these are the three reasons in which these separation techniques are beneficial to us.